Hello everyone, welcome to the virtual field trip of Quaternary geology. So as the first on the first field trip, we'll start taking a look at the Quaternary stratigraphy of the Waterloo region, and we'll start with the Last Glacial Maximum. We talked about the Last Glacial Maximum in the first lecture of the Quaternary framework. So from that, you know already that the region here was fully under the ice sheet. So it was completely covered by ice. The Laurentide ice sheet was about 1.5 kilometer thick. So in the subglacial environment, when the temperature is above the pressure melting point, there can be subglacial erosion, transport, and deposition. There's a little bit of lubrication, there's water, and because of the weight of the ice itself can deform upon its own weight. We'll talk about the details of glacial dynamics in a later lecture, but for now, all you need to understand is that glaciers are dynamic, they deform, and that deformation propagates downward all the way to the ice bed to the bottom, to the ice bed interface. So the ice can slide on its substrate, and by doing this, it can erode material. So it can directly erode bedrock if bedrock is available, but it can also re-entrain pre-existing materials. So it can erode anything, whatever is present under the ice. And so in the Waterloo region, erosion was taking place at that time. So during the Last Glacial Maximum, ice was thick, about 1.5 kilometer thick, and the ice surface slope was essentially going towards the south. And because the ice was so thick, it was not so much under the influence of the local topography. So it was flowing roughly southward across the region. And how do we know this? Well, we know this because of erosional indicators, striations on bedrock, grooves, all kinds of indicators. We'll go again into details about that later, but we know about these ice flow direction. We also know about ice flow direction by looking at the orientation of clasts in sediments, the sediment fabric. So that can tell us something about the direction of shear at the time of transport and deposition. So we can figure out ice flow direction. So we're on the erosional bank of the Grand River. So you see the Grand River is deeply incised into Quaternary sediments. Most of these sediments are glacial in origin. So we'll take a look at some of the stratigraphy of that. But we're on the side of the Grand River, and as you can see on the cross section, on the conceptual regional cross section that's running west to east, you see that the incision of the Grand River has exposed a number of Quaternary units on the erosional banks along the river. So that's an opportunity for us to see units that typically occur in the subsurface that rarely occur at the surface. Okay, so surficial maps are showing you the material that is at the surface, but there are also a lot of subsurface units that don't outcrop very, very often. Do you disagree? So here's the Last Glacial Maximum deposit in the Waterloo region. As you can see from this small section, it's a very poorly sorted mixture of sediments. So you have clay, you have larger clasts, you have a very wide range of material. So that was deposited under the ice under traction, frictional processes. This unit in the Waterloo region has a name. It's called the Catfish Creek Till. It's a remarkable unit. It's a really good, important marker bed in the area because it's got unique characteristics. One of the key characteristics that make it easily recognizable, even by drillers, by anyone working with subsurface material, is that it's very stiff. It's characterized by a state of over-consolidation. We'll get into the meaning of this in a moment, but just hear the sound of the shovel as I try to dig a hole in this. So this is very stiff. It's very stiff material, and we say it's over-consolidated. The reason why it's over-consolidated, it's because it was underneath very thick ice. Now, part of the weight of the ice is supported by the water pressure at the base of the ice. And but in some cases, that water pressure is exceeded by the cryostatic pressure, the weight of the glacier. And when that happens, the glacier pushes down and compresses the material, and it increases its density, and it becomes very stiff and dry like this. So this is one key characteristic of the Catfish Creek Till Unit, is it's a subglacial diamicton, and because it's of glacial origin, we call it a till. So till is a genetic term for glacial diamicton of glacial origin, okay? The Catfish Creek Till, as I said, is a good marker bed because of its unique characteristics, but it's also fairly extensive. It's laterally extensive unit, so it doesn't occur everywhere. It's discontinuous, but it's one of the most continuous quaternary quaternary unit in the area. So it occurs in a lot of places. So it's very extensive, and it's generally quite thick as well. On average, based on drilling and 3D geological modeling in the region, the Catfish Creek Till is on average about 15 meter thick. So 15 meters in thickness, although it can reach thicknesses up to 60 meters. So in some places it's very thick. And that brings up the question of how can, you know, such thick unit can be generated. We'll talk about these problems later. But keep in mind, the Catfish Creek Till is laterally continuous with very few discontinuities, and it's about 15 meter in thickness on average in the Waterloo region. And it generally occurs in the subsurface, but it outcrops along erosional river banks like this and other places where erosion has removed some of the younger units. So the Catfish Creek Till is overlain by younger units that were deposited during the glaciation, and these units have very different characteristics. So if we take a closer look at this material, you see that there's relatively high matrix content, and the clasts are sort of floating in that matrix. So when this is the case, these diamicton are referred to as matrix supported. So there's a matrix support, and the clasts are not, most of the clasts are not touching each other. And as I mentioned earlier, because there's little water involved in this, in the production of this material, you see that the clasts are not very well rounded. Most of them are angular, subangular, sometimes sub-rounded. Of course you can find rounded material in there because they may be recycled. They may have been re-entrained from older fluvial deposits, and though they were already rounded when they got incorporated into this. But if the clasts were produced directly by this process, they'll be angular to subangular like this. And they can be faceted, as you can see. Sometimes they have this triangular shape. In classic textbooks, we refer to these things as iron-shaped clasts and boulders, okay? So, again, the Catfish Creek Till is a matrix-supported diamicton of glacial origin, and it's calcareous, so when you start looking at the composition, and you realize, okay, the matrix is calcareous, it's got a fairly high carbonate content. Most of it is dolomite, so the calcite to dolomite ratio is fairly low. So that's another characteristic that is particular to that till, relative to some other tills in the region, okay? So the matrix is silty, sandy, it's calcareous, the clasts are faceted, some of them are striated. There's a lot of carbonates, of course, in there. But because the Catfish Creek Till is derived from the LGM, a time of very thick ice and flowing mostly towards the south, it has a higher Canadian shield content than most other
tills in the area. So here's an example. So we're quite far from the Canadian Shield boundary, and yet this till has a lot of these erratics. So lots of material derived from the Canadian Shield in that till compared to some other till sheets. Here are some examples of glacial clasts. You see that even though some are sub-rounded, they still have subangular edges. They're faceted, they're polished as well. And if you pay close attention to the surface texture, you'll see that some of them have fine striations. And in this case, they're going all over the place. They're going in different direction. And that's because clasts, while they're being transported in that till layer or at the base of the ice, they're going to rotate, they'll interact with other clasts around, and they'll acquire over time these wear patterns as well as the polishing and the striations. The lithology will play a role in determining, you know, for clasts to acquire striations like this. So the fine soft rocks like carbonate, like limestones or other carbonate rocks, are fairly good at acquiring fine, you know, delicate striations like this. If you take a coarser grain rock like a metamorphic or igneous rock like this one here, it's much more difficult. So you won't necessarily find striations on all of the clasts, but as soon as you see that in a number of clasts and they're faceted like this in a deposit, you know for sure that it's a glacial deposit. There are no other processes, no other environments that can generate this on Earth. And even like if you were to find this, you know, if a rover were to find this on Mars, then we would interpret this as a glacial deposit as well. So these are very unique diagnostic characteristic of glacial sediments, especially subglacial traction tills. And you see that all of these characteristics, so faceted, subangular, striated, polished, etc. So these are typical textbook example of glacial clasts. And again, in typical subglacial traction till, you've got lots of matrix like this. And in the case of the catfish, it has a fairly high content of fairly high clast content. As I said, it's calcareous. It's got also lots of shield derived clast as well because of the ice flow direction. So the units, so here we see the Catfish Creek till, the way it outcrops naturally, there's some slump on top of it. So it's not necessarily clean and nice, but you see all the clast, so it's very stone rich, and you see the Grand River again here. And the Catfish Creek till here is overlain by younger deglacial sediments. Some of these sediments may be, as we discussed before in the lecture, they may be glacial lacustrine. So lacustrine in origin can be fluvial in origin. So when they're lacustrine in origin, they tend to have much higher clay content. And so you can see, for example, here, the unit is darker, and clearly it's got much more clay in this. There's much more clay in this material. And I would have to dig a lot more to find a pebble. But there are some pebbles in this unit. I just haven't found one in this small hole here. But sometimes during the glaciation, what happened is the glacial lakes in front of the glacier deposited clay, and then the ice re-advanced over its own lake in the proglacial environment, and then the clay of the lake became under the ice and got reincorporated and mixed in with new till, and it creates a clay-rich diamicton with that's massive. It doesn't have the typical laminated layers of lacustrine deposits, so it's massive and it's got a few clasts in it, and so on. And so a lot of people here have interpreted these massive clast pore silty to clayey material. They've interpreted these things as till as well, even though they look very different in the Catfish Creek till. And that's because they're essentially made of glacial lacustrine material that's been churned and re-entrained by an ice re-advance. So this unit here is mapped in the region as a till, and it's called the Mary Hill till. Okay, but we'll take a look at true unambiguous laminated glacial lake sediments, and you'll see the difference. Okay, but this is massive, and it's got a few stones in it. If we were to look a little bit more, we would find, but it's got a low percentage of clasts, but it's very massive, and sometimes it's quite stiff as well. But so this is believed to have been overridden by ice, and it's mapped as the Mary Hill till. But most of the material is derived from originally from glacial lake sediments during the overall deglaciation.